Yes.
That's why our 40-year commitment to federalism is more important than ever. Our next speaker is one of the country's foremost authorities on successful messaging to those engaged citizens and following the data to effectively serve our constituents.
Everything
and communities
to people. Can we look at data?
With a finger on the pulse of the country,
know how to interpret
he is a best-selling author, world-renowned pollster, prolific political analyst, and top podcaster. Please join me in welcoming Scott Rasmussen.
Woo! My hero!
Okay, you're just going to be in the shot the whole time.
That's why it's important to keep control at the state.
If you don't mind. Just.
Now, I've spent the last 2 months working with Steve Moore and the America First Policy Institute and a number of other organizations and Save America Coalition trying to kill the big government socialism bill. And my role in that has been exactly infrastructure bill passed and the other bill didn't. They're just not paying attention because there are so many $1 trillion bills. They all start to sound the same. You know, somebody like Steve Moore made a difference between a million and a trillion, but I haven't, and nobody else does either. So he said, let's not talk about the dollars. Because if I tell somebody it's across this budget, it doesn't really connect. We're going to start talking about the policies. What are people going to do with these dollars? And right away, and I'm sure everybody in this room can come up with what they think are stupid ideas. You have a bunch of ideas suggested that these are really offensive things in this bill. One of them was, and you may not know this, there's a provision in the bill for tree equity. $2.5 billion to plant trees. But you know what? Doesn't pull all that badly. There's a provision for a climate conservation corps. That doesn't pull all that badly either. Details about mail-in voting. one thing when we talk about election reform, it has nothing to do with Donald Trump. Back in the 1990s, some of you remember those days, back in the 1990s, I was polling when Bill Clinton was president, and half of all Americans thought that the elections were fair to voters. Just half. Turns out Democrats thought they were fair, Republicans disagreed. George W. Bush got elected. 50% still said they supported, they thought elections were fair. This time it was Republicans who thought it was fair and Democrats who didn't. I was talking to Walter Blackman about this at breakfast. You know, this sense that there is a problem that just popped up recently is wrong. We've had this problem now for decades. It's gotten worse. As we are here today, a majority of Democrats continue to believe that Hillary Clinton was the legitimate winner of the 2016 election. And a majority of Republicans believe that Donald Trump was the legitimate winner in 2020. What that means is only one out of four voters thinks the right person was named president in both 2016 and 2020. That's not a partisan issue. That's a real crisis for a nation that is supposed to be founded on principles of consent of the government. That is a problem that we need to address to restore confidence in the founding ideals of our nation. So when we talk about it, we shouldn't be talking about what happened in the last election or anything in particular. We should be talking about what are sound principles of reform. What are the ideas that would make it easier to vote and harder to shape? And let's not talk about creating the perfect. You know, everybody in here probably has their pet peeve about elections. Let's just focus on the big issues. Let's require photo ID. Let's make sure voter rolls are clean. Let's make sure the ballots are in by election day. And after that, well, then we can see what the next steps are. When we talk about elections, obviously that's one of the hot topics, and the election in Virginia a few weeks ago showed that education is another hot topic. I've already mentioned that critical race theory is not something that people talk about and know about. What really drove that education part of that was the fact that school boards, six parents, school boards, and one of the candidates for governor said parents shouldn't be playing this role in their children's education. They shouldn't have the right to decide to tell schools what to teach their kids. Obviously, didn't know how to turn my phone off when that happened, so I'm learning that. When school boards make these decisions, it gives you an opportunity, or gives our system an opportunity, to make a choice available to everyone. And that's something we ought to focus on. So how do you, the question should not be, how do we give parents absolute control and get school boards out of this? The question should be, what kind of policies can we implement that would let parents have the final decision in terms of how their children are being taught? And there's an interesting twist on this that I think we're all in danger of missing. What's happened in the last couple of years, parents have seen a lot more about what goes on in the education system. Something else that's happened is they've begun to get used to some different things. Right now, among people who believe the worst, among parents who believe the worst of the pandemic is behind us, people who think, you know, we should be safe now, we should be able to get back to normal. A significant number of them are also saying they want a hybrid system of education, a mix of in-person and virtual education. Why? It's not because they're afraid of their kid getting sick. It's because, let me know, we're going to a family event next week. It'd be great if on Thursdays and Fridays we could have the chance to let our child take their class on a virtual basis. Or we have a family vacation coming. Parents are beginning to say, look at education differently. It's a great opportunity, and this is going to reshape education. We're trying to figure out how to do it. Parents, though, as they begin to negotiate all these choices, and I think that's the way that parents ultimately have control of the process. And if I was a state legislator, rather than thinking about how to sell a policy that I've been trying to sell for the last 10 years, I would think about what's education look like. Now I'm going to close in just a minute, and before I do that, I want to say if you go to my website, scottrasmussen.com, you can get a newsletter anytime, and I'll be around the rest of the conference if you want to talk about anything. I want to talk to people about how to message effectively on issues that are important to them. But I want to talk about something in a very big picture way. For many, many years, people have said that the political right is about freedom. Political left is about equality. The great tragedy in our political system today is that many people on the left have abandoned the idea of equality. They want to pursue equity instead. We need a system of both freedom and equality. We need people who will lift up both sides of that equation. And a lot of times, conservatives get kind of uncomfortable talking about equality. I would encourage you to read the Tocqueville's Democracy in America. You don't even have to get through the first paragraph before he says the most essential thing you have to understand about Americans is their sense of equality. He was talking about it in terms of equality of standing before the law, equality of opportunity. He knew it was flawed and imperfect. But we need to reclaim all of those ideas. And the encouraging news is 85% of voters believe that America was founded on the ideals of freedom, equality, and self-governance. They look back at our nation, they don't see something that's evil and horrible. What they see is a nation that made a lot of mistakes. We've had some serious challenges, especially in the area of racial injustice. But they also see a nation that is making progress towards those goals. And what makes this really exciting is 83% of voters believe that America's founding ideals are worth fighting for. And I'm one of those 83%, but I hope that you are too. Thank you very much.
Because we had great information. I'd like to continue.